Saludos a Miguel Pérez. The estimates vary. Somewhere between the year 2005 and 2015, Latinos will be the largest minority in America. This fast-growing population is drawing the attention of politicians, advertising, the media, government, Wall Street, you name it. Yet while everyone is focused on the Latinization of America, few are talking about the fact that the Latino population is aging rapidly. Few are talking about the problems the Latino elderly face. How will they deal with language barriers, loneliness, depression, and other health problems? Will the Latinos be able to continue to take care of the elderly at home? Presently, one-third of Hispanics, 65 to 74 years of age, have diabetes, compared to only 17% of the non-Hispanic white population. By the year 2000, Latino baby boomers, 45 and older, will make up one-third of the population with diabetes. Already, diabetes in children has tripled over the last 5 years, and that's just one area of concern. Today on our show, we will discuss the issue of aging in the Latino community with our distinguished guest, Edna Alvarez. Alex is the president of the National Association of Social Workers New Jersey chapter, and she's also the founder of the National Hispanic Council on Aging. And on the phone from Turlock, California, we have David Roth, the communications director for Medic Alert, a nonprofit membership organization serving over 2.5 million Americans. Mr. Roth, I understand you have to leave in a few minutes, so let me start with you. Do you hear me?
Yes, I do.
Please tell us about Medic Alert. I understand that it has saved some 80,000 lives. How does it work?
That's correct. The service consists of two parts. There is an identification emblem, which you can wear as a bracelet or a necklace, and it is backed by a 24-hour telephone hotline that can provide emergency medical information to anyone at any time, anywhere in the globe, simply with a telephone call. And the emblem carries the universal medical symbol, so when emergency workers see it, they know that the person wearing it has some sort of a medical condition that they need to communicate, and they need to communicate it in a hurry. When they turn that emblem over, they learn of your most critical medical facts, and they know to call the 24-hour hotline for more information, such as your medications, things you're allergic to, plus your family and physician contacts. And there are a lot of medical conditions that require ID, but the most common are allergies to medications like aspirin and penicillin, and chronic conditions to diabetes, as you mentioned.
How do they help the Latino community, especially our Latino elderly?
Well, I think that the most important thing, if you are diabetic, which is what you were speaking of earlier, It alerts emergency responders to the fact that you need special treatment in an emergency. If you go into a hypoglycemic state, say while you're in public or while you're driving, it's extremely dangerous. So if you forget to take insulin or you don't eat properly, your blood sugar can drop too low. And when this happens, you can become dizzy, you can begin to lose consciousness, and sometimes you can't speak, or you may become very agitated or belligerent. So in a public situation, if police say mistake you as a diabetic for somebody who is drunk or on drugs, it can be very dangerous. And that's why it's extremely important, if you are diabetic, to have medical identification so that people who are treating you know what your condition is and they won't misinterpret it, and you can receive the appropriate medical attention.
Basically, the idea is to prevent misdiagnosing.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Let me ask you, the diabetes situation is particularly prevalent, from what I understand, in the Puerto Rican and the Mexican-American community. Are you aware of that situation?
We are very much aware of that situation. And in fact, when I first learned the statistics involved with Hispanics and diabetes, I found it to be a rather amazing fact. The most significant risk factor for diabetes is what's called impaired glucose tolerance. What it means is that your body does not process sugars correctly, and it's found in half of all Mexican Americans and Puerto Ricans over age 55.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
And compared to whites, the rate of diabetes is about 120% higher for Mexican Americans and about 60% higher for Cuban Americans.
Mm-hmm.
And then as you get older, the statistics tend to get worse. From 34 to 74, about 24% of all Mexican Americans have diabetes. So as you pointed out, by about 2000, Hispanics will make up about one-third of the diabetic population.
Mm-hmm. Since Latinos keep going back to their homelands, how does the tag work when they go abroad?
If you have a medical emergency abroad and we receive a phone call, we have a number of operators who are fluent in Spanish, but if they happen to call one of the operators who is not, all we have to do is press a button. We have translators that come on the line that can translate the conversation into English from any one of 140 different languages.
So doctors can get this information from anywhere?
Doctors can call us, collect from any place on the globe, and get your medical information.
Okay, and one last important question. Where do they call for information on MedicAlert?
24 hours a day, you can call 1-800-ID-ALERT, and you can find out information about MedicAlert or join right over the telephone.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Roth, thank you very much for being with us and for providing that important information. We really appreciate it.
Thank you, Miguel.
You take care.
Bye-bye.
Ms. Alex, it's a pleasure having you on the program.
Thank you very much, Miguel.
What do you think about this particular issue that we're discussing right now when it affects the Latino community, the Latino aging community, the diabetes problem, and how this brace affects diabetes?
Well, like you said, one of the problems that we've experienced when we work with an elderly person who's diabetic is that if they go out in the community and they have an attack and they don't have an identification, something that identifies that they're a diabetic, most oftentimes they're seen as being alcoholics, you know, and not only that, but if they're taken to the hospital, if they were wearing the alert bracelet, they would be able to give them something right away instead of, you know, taking time to diagnose. So it's a good medical piece that could be very helpful.
Mm-hmm.
But not too many wear them.
That was my next question. Are people aware of the tag or the bracelet? Are they using it? I guess it's the same problem that leads to my next question. The problem that we have in our community, that a lot of our people are just not aware of what is available
right
to them.
Or if they're aware, they do not know how to use it and all the factors that go along with it.
So why let's talk about awareness. Why aren't our people more aware? Do we have do we lack the resources to get this information on just health problems in general for the elderly, services that are available for the elderly? How do we get the word out, and whose fault is it that it's not getting out?
Well, it's hard to blame, you know, as to whose fault, because it has to do with the language barrier. It has to do also with the lack of access. Although there are services in place, we find that Hispanics tend not to use them. Again, it's the language barrier, lack of education, not understanding. The other issue is that sometimes agencies will write something in Spanish. If it's brought home, they have a grandchild that may be able to read it, but he can't read Spanish. So what we try to do is let people know that they should do it both in English and Spanish so that the grandchild or the child can read it to their grandparents.
What about healthcare providers? Where does the Latino, is there a problem with the Latino community getting the health care that they need in terms of information, in terms of knowing who the best healthcare provider is? How do they assess, how to go about choosing healthcare?
Well, one of the issues is that because of poverty, many of our Hispanic elderly are eligible for a program called Social Security Supplemental Income, mm-hmm. SSI, mm-hmm. which has a component of a medical coverage, Medicaid,
mm-hmm.
but oftentimes they do not know all the factors that Medicaid covers. And the other issue is that not all doctors accept Medicaid, so they have to go to clinics, and oftentimes they don't know what questions to ask or to follow the directions or prescriptions, you know, that the doctors give them. I would like, though, if it's possible, although it seems like we're painting a bleak picture, there are some positive and negative factors to the that affect the Hispanic elderly. And what we're finding is that on the positive side, the Hispanic elderly, they seem to have a very hopeful attitude. They have strong faiths. They have strong family ties. And most oftentimes, even though they have these problems, they seem to deal with the situation. 10% of our Hispanic elderly are guardians to foster parent to a child under the age of 18. Most Hispanics, 65, can count on a child to take care of them. So right now, there are not too many in nursing homes. The Hispanic elderly has a strong work ethic. They're frugal with their dollars. And those who can vote do go, their greatest percentage do go out and vote. The only problem is that although we are increasing in numbers, many of them are residents. They're not citizens. And so therefore, when we're talking about policies, if you cannot vote, you know, the politicians are not so apt to be, you know.
Is there, because Latinos do take care of the elderly at home still in great numbers, is there an increasing demand, however, on home care?
Yes.
Tell me about
that. There is, because there are more Hispanic females between the ages of 24 and 54 going out to the workforce. And of course, you know, they're the caregivers. And what has happened is that at one time, it was a luxury for a woman to go out to work. Right now, it's a necessity. And there are no caregivers in the home. And we do not have sufficient services for home care for the elderly, especially when we're talking about monolingual. They need people that speak Spanish. The other issue is that the health care society has not given recognition to the home care provider. Consequently, these people do not get paid very well. And when you're talking about getting a bilingual person who drives so they can get to the person's home and has a little bit of education, they're not going to be so willing to take a job that pays $7 to $9. Mm-hmm. And so we don't get an awful lot of Hispanic home health aides going out into the community. Mm-hmm. Unless like, for instance, in Perth Amboy, they're able to walk to their clients' homes. And, you know, so we seem to have some coverage there. But that's an issue. I think that we need to recognize home care profession, the home care help as a profession, and pay them what they're worth and give them the benefits. A lot of people don't get those benefits, so it's difficult to find home care
services. You mentioned some of those positive things that we have going for our elderly. What are some of the negative things?
Well, the negative things are our seniors right now have a low level of education. And I just want to quote something from a psychiatrist and neurologist who states that numerous surveys have conclusively found that higher levels of education have a positive correlation with better health and a longer life, and even protect an individual from depression. Scientists have reasoned that better educated individuals are more aware of health risk factors, are better able to implement healthier lifestyle choices, feel a great sense of empowerment and self-esteem, and have a greater problem-solving skill and more effective coping strategies.
So education is a key factor.
Education is a key factor, not only for the Hispanic elderly, but for our young children. I really believe that when we develop policies, we need to look at an intergenerational relationship, because what will happen in the year 2050, the Hispanic population, the young people are the ones who are going to go to the workforce and will be paying into the system so that the elderly could be maintained. And most of the elderly, Hispanic elderly, will be 85 and over. Mm-hmm. So what will happen is, it's called a dependency ratio. You'll have a lot of young under the age of 21 children, a lot of them Hispanic, and you'll have a lot of 85-year-olds, but not too many in the workforce, the work age. And the ones that are in the work age, if they're not working in technology or good jobs where they're going to be able to put into the system, mm-hmm. it's going to be difficult, not only for the elderly, but for the, you know, the entire population also, because the studies also say that the white Anglo is also going to increase, and they're going to actually be depending on minorities that are working. Mm-hmm. Of course, that's it. Of course, you know, the social security system stays mm-hmm. as is. And the other issue is that the Hispanic community, we're very today oriented. And not only that, even if we wanted to save, we're not making enough money to be able to meet all our needs and put money aside. But we need to develop programs that will help Hispanic Hispanics, save some money and invest so that when they get on their years, they'll be able to not just count on Social Security, which is what most of the Hispanic elderly do now, but count on some investments and, you know, and so that they can better, they can deal better with the situation.
You have consulted with several New Jersey governors on the problems of the aging. I'm wondering what you tell them. What is it that you, especially when it comes to the Hispanic elderly, if I was Governor Whitman, what would you be telling me?
We need to look at the strengths of a community, not just Hispanics, but Asians that are also growing in number. We need to look at their strengths, and we need to work with their strengths. We need to enhance what they already have, and we need to facilitate so that the entire community, it's not just the aged, but it's a whole family. I really believe that we need to look at an intergenerational approach to developing policies. So what I would tell our governor is that we need to develop policies that are going to be good for everyone, because in the long run, it'll be good for the entire community.
I understand you have a theory that Hispanic elderly are in triple jeopardy.
Yes.
What does that mean?
Triple jeopardy means that they're poor, they're aged, and they're a minority. But you know, only a minority in the fact that they come from a different island or a different country. Not in numbers. We have an awful lot of Hispanics. The problem is that not all of them can vote. And from my experience, because we've had various conferences throughout the years, I invited politicians to be at those conferences, and they didn't show. Mm-hmm. And they had a group that, you know, would be able to voice their opinions. Mm-hmm. There are services around, I mean, and the system tries to help, but we need to find out what's keeping the Hispanic elderly from accessing the system. Mm-hmm. It's not something that just happened this year. It's happened all along since the 1980 White House conference, where people felt that we needed to focus more on the aging population because of demographics. We still don't have the Hispanic accessing what's already out there.
Well, the thing is, see, I have this mm-hmm. theory, and correct me if I'm wrong, the problem, again, falls into our culture, our mm-hmm. traditions, mm-hmm. the fact that they stay home mm-hmm. and get taken care of by their sons and daughters, and they may not participate in a community center.
Okay.
They may not be going to other activities with other elderly
people.
That's how they don't get to find out
right.
what is out there.
But the reason they don't do that is that sometimes our system has a way of developing programs that the system feels are good without the input of the people that they're giving services to.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to get people from the community. That's why I believe that you need to go to where they're at, see what the strengths, see what works. Like, for instance, many of the Hispanic elderly have no problem attending church functions.
Mm-hmm.
You know, go to the churches, work with them. I know that there's an issue with state and church, you know, but you need to go where the people are at, and you need to find ways of getting the information across. We have very good services. New Jersey, I feel very proud, has very good services for the elderly, but mm-hmm. for some reason, the Hispanic are not accessing those services.
But again, when you're an older person and you're looking for a community center, your mm-hmm. Hispanic older person, if you live in an urban area where there's an important community service agency that is providing those services, and you're lucky.
Mm-hmm.
But if you live in an area where there are not too many Hispanics,
mm-hmm.
and that happens throughout the
right.
state of New Jersey, and you're isolated in a sense,
mm-hmm.
you live with your own family,
mm-hmm.
you don't depend on a nursing home or any
right.
other outside activity, then you're isolated even
mm-hmm.
more by the fact that
mm-hmm.
your family takes care
right.
of you, and perhaps you don't get to find out all the services that are available
mm-hmm.
to
mm-hmm.
you. And I've seen it, because I've done stories
mm-hmm.
on this. I've seen it in Bergen County for a while, when the Hispanic elderly did not have a community
right.
center of their own,
right.
and they would go to other community centers
mm-hmm.
and feel alienated because
right.
they didn't understand the language.
Mm-hmm.
Or, I remember a lady saying, they don't even play dominoes here.
Right. Well, not only did they not, I've always wanted to get an artist to make a picture of a Hispanic elderly going into a senior citizen's building with a very colorful coat
mm-hmm.
of our culture, the music, the
mm-hmm.
games we play, the stories we tell, but in entering, they have to take that coat off and basically be naked, really, because...
Well, you have to melt
into the pot. And there have been some centers that have been very successful. I mean, I can, you know, talk about Perth Amboy community-based organizations that try very hard to accommodate the culture, the language, the food. That's another thing. There are an awful lot of Hispanic elderly that do not make use of what they call Meals on Wheels. Because they, you know, it's Anglo food. I mean, I happen to like American food, but not everybody does. I know my parents wouldn't eat it.
Especially if you're a recent arrival.
Right.
I mean, they have, the ones who are recently arrived, mm-hmm. per se, in the last five or six years, mm-hmm. they have additional problems and barriers, don't they?
Mm-hmm.
What
yes,
are
they
those?
Do. Well, the problem is that many of them are not, they're not citizens. And at one time, I mean, this was just about 2 years ago, there was that issue about
taking,
if you were not a citizen and you were, it was horrendous what we went through. And many of the seniors were so stressed they even became ill.
And many became citizens.
Right. That was a positive. As a matter of fact, I have elderly people who are now citizens and their children are still not citizens. So
and
that was a positive.
And many of them became citizens and then they realized, well, I didn't need it after all, but there was a threat that they could have lost
a lot of
benefits.
But you know what? They were so proud. That was wonderful. They're very proud. Those are difficulties. Immigration is very difficult. I mean, it's a maze. You know, I've been a social worker now 24 years. I still don't understand it. And you feel so frustrated not being able to help someone. And it also creates an exploitive type of situation because there's some people, you know, that take advantage of the fact, well, you know, you have to get papers, you have to, you know, pay for the immigration applications, and you have to go here and you have to go there. And it makes it very hard for them. As a matter of fact, right now there's a
also they haven't paid, the recently arrived haven't really paid enough into the Social Security system. How does that work for them? How do they live?
They depend on their children. They depend on their children, and that's a hardship on the families, and that's why young families, also one of the reasons why they can't save and plan for their own aging with, you know, when they retire. And so, yes, right now we have Hispanics who are well educated, unlike, you know, their parents. And you would think, well, when they retire, they're going to be better off. Not necessarily so, mm-hmm. because there are many Hispanic families now paying for the home care, paying for the special diets that some of the people like diabetics, mm-hmm. you know, need. So, yes, the Hispanic community, now the young people are better educated, but it's not really going to make that much of a difference in the year 2050 if we do not facilitate and work with those families now, mm-hmm. to help them take care of their parents. Because one of the things that is happening to the Hispanic community is we are living longer, and thank God that's wonderful to know, you know, but it also creates a problem. Mm-hmm. If the system doesn't work along with the reality.
What about people who haven't donated enough to the Social Security system, like migrant workers? What kind of protection do they have?
Right now, if a person has been in the states with a residence card that shows that they've been here 5 years, they would be eligible for what they call Social Security supplemental income if they're over 65. And it gives them, right now, I think that the minimum, actually the max is $525 plus Medicaid. So if you do have the right credentials and you're a resident, you would be eligible for that, and that comes along also with Medicaid. But again, even though you have this, like for instance, some of my seniors have Medicaid, they're still not able to get the home care that they need because they do not have the workforce, the people that speak Spanish or know how to cook the meals to be able to come into their home. So yes, they have coverage, but they're still not getting the services that they need.
I always hear that there's a big problem among our Latino elderly, a problem with depression.
Yes.
That they're very depressed.
Mm-hmm.
What are they depressed over?
Well, there are many reasons why they're depressed. One of the reasons also is that many of them, the Hispanics have a tendency of having a lot of chronic illnesses. When you have chronic illnesses and they're being addressed medically, you're taking different types of medication. Sometimes medications make you depressed. Like I said before, the Hispanic culture is seen as a happy culture.
But is
it's
it,
just,
is,
but
Is it also a problem that they don't see themselves as contributing members of society because they got here, their children are working, their children are speaking English, their children are moving into a new millennium and a new society, and they are sort of like isolated? Is that part of what's causing the depression?
From my experience, no. I find that Hispanic elderly are still in tune with their families and their grandchildren. Some, yes, are isolated because, for instance, a daughter or son got a new job, and now they're going to be living in suburbia. Mm-hmm. That person may become depressed mm-hmm. because they don't have other people to talk to. Mm-hmm. But if they're living, let's say, in a city like Perth Amboy, they're able to get out, so it makes a big difference.
I hear this problem all the time where mm-hmm. they're moving me out of El Barrio.
Right.
And now I'm not going to be able to speak Spanish or go to the bodega.
Right.
I can actually walk to the bodega where I live now, but once they move me out to the suburbs, I'll depend on a car.
And that's where I find
people. Speak English.
That's how where I find people are most depressed, when they do not have that support system other than their families. Mm-hmm. And again, because the language barrier also impedes their ability to go to a senior citizen and participate.
We're out of time, but I thank you very much. I think you've made a tremendous contribution
thank
to informing our viewers. I'm Miguel Perez, and we remind you to check us out at www.njlatinos.com. Find out what's happening on this program, and we'll see you next week on another edition of Images e Imágenes. Hasta pronto.